Dr. Madhvi Narsalai is an assistant professor at the Department of Sanskrit at the University of Mumbai, where she has been as a full-time faculty for more than two decades, teaching Veda, Vedanta, Dharmashastra, Arthashastra, as well as epics and Puranas. An erudite scholar, her works have been published in international and national journals, such as the Oxford Journal of Hindu Studies, the Journal of the Asiatic Society of Mumbai, and the Journal of the Oriental Institute, Vadodara. She has contributed chapters on goddesses and Marathi saint literature in books published by international scholars and academics. She has written two books covering the Vedic religion and edited three books on contemporary Sanskrit literature, feminism, and mysticism. She has presented research papers in national and international conferences, such as the World Sanskrit Conferences held in Delhi, Bangkok, and Vancouver. She has represented India in the first yoga conference held at New York. Towards creating awareness about Sanskrit literature, Dr. Madhvi continues to write in popular publications and dailies such as Lok Sakha, Lok Prabha, and Manokamala. She has received the Performance-Based Incentive Award by the University of Mumbai in 2009 towards her work in the area of research and pedagogy. And in 2018, she received the Samudra Manthan Award for her contribution to the Sanskrit language and Indian culture. Very honored to have you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
So I will introduce you Roberto Capalano. Roberto was for many years co-director of the International Office for Interreligious Dialogue of the Focolare Movement in Rome, Italy. He is a professor of theology and praxis of interreligious dialogue and of Theor Ethics of Dialogue at Sofia University Institute in Lupiano, Florence, Italy, at the Saint Veronquant in Montaigne, Switzerland, and Exos Accademia di Scienze Umane e Sociali in Rome, Italy. He lived in India for 28 years, where he worked as cultural officer at the Consulate General of Italy. Actively involved in interreligious dialogue for the last 25 years, he has organized several symposia and interfaith events in India and in Rome, and published four books and many articles. So I pass on to Dr. Madhvi to introduce.
A very good evening to all of you. And so we are at the juncture of listening to a very erudite personality called Roberto Catalano. And I thank the Ecumenical Christian Center, then Sri Ramakrishna Mission and the Focolare Movement for conceiving such a very beautiful course on interfaith, interreligious dialogue for fellowship. So this is really a very interesting lineup of lectures by scholars who are of national and international repute. And today we have a person like Roberto. I had the fortune of interacting with him in some of the Focolare Movement's dialogues in Mumbai. At Lonavala I met him. Then he was the host for the Focolare Movement's meeting in Rome at Castel Gundolfo, and he was the host over there. So I had the fortunate opportunity for interacting with him. And today, not taking much of your time, today I will request him to speak on dialogue of a prophecy, a common phenomenon. And I request him to begin his speech, and the participants who have got questions, I request them to write the questions on the chat box, so that we will take those questions at the end of the lecture. So over to you, Professor Roberto.
Thank you so much, Madhvi. I hope you can all hear me well.
Yes.
Is it okay? Yeah, first of all, greetings to everyone. It's a pleasure to be with all of you. In a special way, greetings to Father Matthew, who has conceived, along with the Focolare Movement, the Ramakrishna Mission, and some of us also at Sofia University, this program. Really congratulations, because these formation programs on interfaith dialogue are really the need of the time, and it is really inspiring that institutions connected with the religious reality mastermind this kind of programs. For me, whenever I have to deal with India and with Indians and Indian religions, is always a great joy. By the way, today it's a very auspicious day for me, because 41 years ago, on this day, I came to know that I was given the possibility of coming to India. And I didn't know anything. At the time, the proposal was to come to India for 6 months. And in the end, I stayed for 28 years, which I consider a blessing. And this evening, a book would be released on my experience of these 28 years in India. So it's a very particularly significant day for me. I will deal in my presentation with a topic which is probably a bit new for most of us. And it's part of my research for quite some time. In fact, some of the people present here might have heard some of the things that I'm going to say. It has been part of my research, because the more I lived in interfaith dialogue, the more I realized that there are many, not only people, but also groups involved in interfaith dialogue. And sometimes the role of these communities, groups, movements is downplayed or overlooked. So I'll try to present this aspect, this dimension, which I will try to summarize in the time which has been allotted to me, and I will ask Madhvi to help me to stay in the 40 minutes they told me for my presentation. And I hope the image is visible for all of you. Can you see it well?
Yes.
Yeah, yeah. Now I put as a title of this moment of sharing, dialogue as a prophecy, a common phenomenon. And when I speak of common, I speak of common among different religions. So not only in India, not only within Christianity, but different religions. And the subtitle explains this: movements as vehicles for interreligious dialogue. As I told you, interfaith dialogue is not carried out only or conceived by individuals, but also by groups, communities, and movements. Now, I will focus mainly on four of these movements. One is the Focolare Movement. I think the Sherilyn Meneses spoke about it last time. Another one is the Rishoko Sekai, which is of Japanese origin, and it's basically Buddhist. Another one is a Turkish movement, basically Muslim, Gülen, called in Turkish Hizmet, which means service. If we want in Hindi, Seva. And then I will mention in the course of the presentation also Gandhian movements. Of course, I will not focus. You understand that to speak in depth of all these movements, it will take long presentations, and this is not the case for today. Now, I will speak, of course, as a Catholic, as a Christian. And I must say that as a Catholic for a long time, we all thought that these movements, these new realities, were born only in the Catholic Church, because in fact the Catholic Church experienced the birth, the presence of these movements, which are called also renewal movements, spiritual and social renewal movements. And they were born either before or during or after a big event which took place in the Catholic Church. Probably it has been mentioned in the last lectures that you had, called the Vatican Council, the Second Vatican Council, which was a meeting of all the bishops of the Catholic Church along with the Pope in Rome between 1962 and 1965. But of course, the more we go ahead, the more we realize that these renewal movements are not confined only within Christianity. They are present in all religions. And this was quite intriguing and quite interesting for me. So I decided to deepen this aspect. And I found very interesting things which I'm going to share with you today. I must say that from the Catholic viewpoint, what happened in the Catholic Church, these movements were prepared and also fostered by different aspects. For instance, a theological reflection. There were theologians who tried to reflect on Christianity, but also on the relationship between Christianity and other religions. Then there were also gestures, very important, by different popes, from John the 23rd, which was who was the one who conceived the council, to Pope Francis, the present pope. Then there were statements, official documents, concrete initiatives, which were organized by Christianity, not only by Christianity, in the last 50 years. And there were also many protagonists, which continued the enterprise of dialogue among people and these hold different beliefs. They belong to different religions. At the same time, you also have huge institutions which began in a very shy way around the 70s of last century. And then more and more they developed in the last few decades, in the last half a century, like the World Conference for Religions and Peace, today is called Only Religions for Peace, the Parliament of World Religions, which was born in 1892, and then for 100 years was dormant, and it was revived exactly 100 years later. Then, for instance, the Interreligious Coordinating Council of Israel, the King Abdullah bin Abdulaziz International Center for Interreligious and Intercultural Dialogue in Vienna, sponsored, by the way, by Saudi Arabia. Now, some of these movements, not all, but some of these movements which were born within Christianity and also other religions, have been important players in the interreligious field. And they make up a very interesting phenomenon, which is taking place sometimes in front of our eyes, and we don't even realize at times. And scholars started now deepening this phenomenon, not only within Christianity, but also scholars from different cultures and religions. As I told you, I will present it from the Christian, from the Catholic viewpoint. And as a Catholic, I cannot but mention the what I mentioned already before, that it was during the second half of last century when there was the Second Vatican Council in Rome, we see an image here, that these new Catholic movements were born. And today they are present in different parts of the world. Now, these movements present a variety of characteristics. They are very different one from the other. And at the same time, they have common features. That is very interesting. In fact, let's say practically all of them are constituted by lay people following a charismatic leader. It's interesting because sometimes in religion, we are used to see, for us Christians, priests, nuns, let's say, concerned about religions. Or in Hinduism, probably the Purohits, the Swamis, or in Islam, the Ayatollah for the Shia Muslims and the Imams for the Sunni Muslims. Instead, these movements are largely inspired and constituted by lay people. The Christian movement have a radical commitment in living the whole gospel. We see then about also movements in other religions. And since the gospel is a book, they have focused one aspect of the gospel in order to make sure that they can live the whole gospel, but by putting into practice in a special way one of the pages of the gospel. And another element is that they ensure a formation to their members. So it's very interesting. Catholic people, lay people who try to form to religion other lay people, something which in a way was unknown within Christianity till then. And they present a very rich variety of patterns. I would say it's like a galaxy within the Catholic Church. Another element, which is common to practically all of them, is that they show a great mobility. In different parts, in different moments of their short history time, because they were born 50, 60, 70, some of them 30, 40 years ago, they spread all over the world, and they have been also successful in taking roots in a cultural and religious context, which are different from the ones where they were born. Moreover, they developed a capability to establish bridges among followers of different religions. And sometimes they were born, for instance, in Italy or in Brazil, where till a few decades ago, all people were Catholics, Christians. Very often, these movements were not pre-planned. They were like a surprise birth within the big family, which is the church. And among them, I focus on two, the Sant'Egidio community and the Focolare movement. They pursue a sort of a practical theology. They also have good theologians, but their theology is very practical, very down to earth, is rooted in daily life of the scriptures. And this enables them to meet with a growing quest for interreligious dialogue, because today people of different cultures, of different religions, meet more and more often, thanks to globalization, so because of globalizations and migrations. And this practical theology, this practical daily living, helps this movement to create something new, which was not there before. At the same time, they are very much interested in, let's say, human practical issues, like justice, peace, religious freedom, social integration, something that at the first sight you say, but these are not religious issues, these are social issues. Instead, they are very much part of the agenda of the growing reality of these groups. What is interesting, that more and more studying the Catholic movements, the Catholic groups, one realizes there are similar phenomena also within the folds of the different religions. And these are also these movements in different religions, some of them are very much involved in interfaith dialogue, and they link very well with the Catholic movements which are sensitive to the issue of dialogue. I'll give you an example. The Mahayana Buddhist movement from Japan, Risho Kosekai, whose founder was here seen along with Kara Lubich, the founder of the Focolare movement, is a outstanding example. He founded this big movement in Japan without knowing that there were other movements even less in the Catholic Church. And when they met this man and this woman, founders of these two movements, charismatic leaders, both working for peace and unity of mankind, it was a big surprise to discover that in Buddhism and Christianity, there was something similar to what they were living. So much so that Nikhil Nibbana, when he came out of the meeting with Kara Lubich, commented, "I thought I was the only mad man in the world." Mad man meaning crazy for peace in the world. And remember that we have to remind ourselves that Japan was completely destroyed by the atomic bombs, at least two big cities during the Second World War. So Nibbana was working for peace. He said, "I thought I was the only mad man believing in unity and peace, and I found another one, a woman who is as mad as I am." At the same time, in Islam, in Turkey, more or less at the same time, Fethullah Gülen, a layman, though he's an imam, but a layman, was instrumental in giving life to a movement called Hizmet, which is a lay movement, which was born in Turkey, and it was meant only for Turkey, and he drew inspiration from Said Nursi, a Sufi author of Turkey. But it's enough to think of some of, in India, of some aspects of the Gandhian movement, which was very much, and it is very much involved in interfaith dialogue, or the Swadhyaya movement founded in Mumbai and in Gujarat, which has been very active also to build bridges with people of every religions within the different villages in many parts of the country in India, but especially in Maharashtra and in Gujarat. Let's go to Taiwan. In Taiwan, the Chan Buddhism has been strongly renewed by some new monasteries, which were founded in the last 50 years, the Fukuan Shan and Dharma Drama in the Chinese island of Taiwan. Within Islam, again, we cannot forget the Muslim followers of Imam W.D. Muhammad, African-American Muslims. And here there was not only a religious need for dialogue, but also an ethnic issue very much at stake, because they are all African-American. Now, I just pinpoint a few elements, but this can be defined with the words of a great German philosopher, Karl Jasper, as an axial period in human history. I'll tell you in a few words what is an axial period in human history. If we think of many of our religions, many of our religions were born between 600 or 800 before Christian era, before Christ, BC, and 200 before Christ. For instance, Zoroastrianism, Buddhism, also certain aspects of Judaism, not to speak of Confucianism, Taoism. So, this philosopher called that an axial period of human history. Why? Because something happened in different parts of the world which was not connected with one to the other. It was much more difficult at the time to travel. So all these founders of great religions founded something immense for the whole of humanity without knowing one about the other. And this makes us think of a hand from above, from heaven, was guiding this. But it's enough to think also of the period between the first and the second millennium after Christ and or the Christian era, when there have been some movements like the Sufi movements or the Bhakti movement or the certain saints in Christianity like Saint Francis and Dominic, they all had a special element which we can call devotion, compassion, mysticism, which showed that all religions, without knowing one of the other or little knowing one of the other, developed something very common. So we call these two axial periods in history of humanity. And we can say that these new realities born in the last 50, 60, 70 years are somehow reminding us, due proportion kept, with these big events in history. Now, many of these organizations, as I mentioned, are trans and cross-national phenomena. And they are very much oriented to interreligious, intercultural dialogue. And they are concerned not so much with a religion inside their respective religions, but outside, towards the others, ad extra, to reach out also other religions. And they try also to rethink religions in world affairs, something that in Europe, for instance, was something unbelievable, because religion in Europe, after the French Revolution, had been completely put in the private sphere of life. And at the same time, all these movements developed an inclusive model of behavior. And this makes them vehicles for peace and dialogue, not only among individuals, but also among communities. And this, of course, becomes very helpful in facing the problems the society has to face today. In fact, their members, though the overwhelming majority are lay people, as we said, they are motivated by a long-term religious commitment. They are not only priests, swamis, nuns, monks who are committed to religious life, but there are lay people who are committed to live a religious life throughout their existence. And on this basis, they build strong relationship one with the other. So let's see briefly some of these some of the characteristics of these movements. Here there are the three charismatic leaders who have been three of the founders. As I mentioned before, and probably as Sherilyn Menezes said last time, the Focolare is one of these within the Catholic Church, which has developed a very active initiatives in the field of interfaith dialogue. It started because Chiara Lubich, the foundress, received the Templeton Prize for the Progress of Religion in 1977. And she considered that event as a starting point for interfaith dialogue within the Focolare movement. She was shocked, positively shocked, when at the end of the ceremony where she was bestowed with this prize, award, were not the Christians or the Catholics who went over to her to greet her and to thank her, but they were the Buddhists, the Hindus, the Sikhs, the Muslims. And she said, "I felt that we have to do something for them, something with them." Then, since the early 80s, she met with the Mahayana Buddhists in Japan, as we have seen before with Nikki Nidano, then with Theravada monks and nuns in Thailand. In the 90s of last century, she met with the Afro-American Muslims in Harlem, in their mosque in Harlem. She was probably the first woman and white woman to speak in their mosque. Then with the Jewish community in Buenos Aires. And then in 2001, 2003, she came also to India, and some of the people present here will remember definitely the meetings that we had with brothers and sisters of different religions. And she commented towards the end of her life, looking back at the long path covered in interfaith dialogue, she commented with these words: "We are always surprised to see that God has led us along a spiritual pathway that intersects with all the other spiritual ways of Christians, but also of the faithful of other religions. In practice, we have become partners along the journey of brotherhood and peace while maintaining our own identity. It enables us to meet and come to a mutual understanding with all the great religious traditions of humanity." So we can see from these words the great surprise. She could not believe herself of what happened. And she further commented, "Working with many brothers and sisters of the major religions and the brotherhood we experienced with them has convinced us that the idea of religious pluralism can shed its connotation of division and conflict and emerge to represent for millions of men and women the challenge of recomposing the unity of the human family. So differences are not a danger, they are a sign of hope to form a human family, so that the Holy Spirit may in some way be present and active in all religions, God's Spirit obviously, not only in the individual members, but also in the inner workings of each religious tradition." Nikki Olivano was older than Chiara Lubich. The Risho Kosekai was established a few years before the movement, the Focolare movement, but he started inter-religious experience in the 60s. And his experience was rooted, of course, in the holy books of the Mahayana Buddhism, in Lotus Sutra. And in commenting the Lotus Sutra, he said that Sakyamuni Buddha advocated flexibility when he taught that one must be candid and open and obedient to the truth. One must be ready to accept new truths when they are discovered. There can be no absolute incompatibility among human beings. This is a truth to which we must all become enlightened. To follow the way of truth is to have spiritual and mental flexibility. The person who has these traits can grow in all directions. You see, a completely different language, a different sensitiveness, the one of a Mahayana Buddhist, but looking towards the same direction. And Nirvana showed commitment to dialogue rooted in a deep spirituality which arises from the awakening of the compassionate mind in Mahayana Buddhism, a great capacity to connect to all living beings, not only to human beings. Caring or worrying, he said, about someone else, or being cared or worried about, is what gives happiness to human life. With this caring, we communicate heart to heart, and such an exchange engenders a profound sense of belonging or oneness. In the Buddhist canon, there is a definition of humanity as that which lives between one person and another. So this is a beautiful definition of humanity, what lives between two persons. Now, after Nirvana met the Focolare movement in 1993, Nirvana, his son, who is the president of the Risho Kosekai, acknowledged something very interesting. They wrote to Chiara Lubich saying, "Only through the grace of God for Christians and Lord Buddha's benevolence for Buddhists, we are engaged in the same mission of working for the salvation of the whole humankind." So there was a common awareness that we work for the same goal, for the same aim. And Chiara Lubich commented, expressing the hope that there may be other movements which have come to life for this very goal, And she commented in her diary, we have to discover them. And so in the course of time, she discovered some of them. Then we come to Fethullah Gülen and his met, which was born, as I said, in Turkey. It was not at all meant for interreligious dialogue. And by the way, we must say that today his met is also going to a very strong hardship because being persecuted by the present government in Turkey. Now, Fethullah Gülen was an imam. He committed himself in education and formation of young generations for the value of peace, mutual understanding, and world harmony. Ismet, which means seva, service, draws inspiration from a Sufi prophet of last century, Saint Nursi, and little by little, also Gülen changed and from a national Islamic character became very much open to all faiths and culture. Now, it's almost impossible to know the number of persons involved in this map, but this is true for the Rishon Kozhikai, for the Focolare, for the African-American Muslims. They are, like all the others, an organization which is a transnational, cross-cultural, ensuring that this Turkish renewal religious movement has a remarkable relevance at the global, social, and inter-religious level of engagement. And someone who wrote about Gülen recently wrote these words, regardless of how their adherents implement their faith in their daily lives, such generally accepted values as love, respect, tolerance, forgiveness, mercy, human rights, peace, brotherhood, and freedom are all values exalted by religion. Most of these values are accorded the highest precedence in the message brought by Moses, Jesus, Muhammad, upon them be peace, as well as in the messages of Buddha, Zarathustra, Lao Tzu, Confucius, and Hindu prophets. What are the commonalities among these movements which seem to have nothing in common because they belong to different religions? Their founders, again, are lay people. They have an anthropological approach which is very close to each other. They have a communitarian dimension and a foundation on the respective scriptures, which they try to interpret in a modern way. And they are rooted, this is very important, in their respective traditions, cultures, and scriptures. Why I say this? They are not in polemic, they are trying to break away from their mainstream religions. Not at all. They are rooted in their own traditions. They share a common vision of the human being, which paves the way towards an awareness of the universal human family, therefore of fraternity. And all men and women are seen as an image of God or an expression of the ultimate reality for the Buddhists. Chiara, for instance, in 1947, this just to give a small example, she wrote in 1947, when she was at the very beginning of the Focolare movement and no idea, for perhaps even of the existence of other religions, she wrote, always fix your gaze on the one father of many children. Then you must see all as children of the same father. In mind and heart, we must always go beyond the bounds imposed on us by human life alone and create the habit of constantly opening ourselves to the reality of being one family in one father, God. So the idea of seeing God present in the other person. And this represents the first intuition of what would become then the root or the roots of interfaith dialogue. All men and women are to be considered as candidates for building a relationship of fraternity and unity. And out of this, Chiara developed an art of loving, an art of dialogue, of which I believe Sherilyn Menezes spoke about last time. But if we go to Fethullah Gulen, we realize that he often quotes Yunus Emre, a famous Turkish mystic of the 13th century. And that mystic said, we love the created creature for the sake of the creator. So the idea is the same of what Chiara expressed in Christian terminology. Because Said Nursi, the mystics to whom Fethullah Gulen, or from whom Fethullah Gulen draws inspiration, always stated that mutual compassion is the pure and powerful way of friendship and brotherhood. So you see, therefore, that, that there is an anthropological interest which is very, very close. And if we speak of Nivano, a Buddhist who tries to draw inspiration from the Lotus Sutra, he says, all human beings are manifestation of the vital force of the universe. Therefore, are equally important and carry the same value. Here is the crucial element for justifying the potential harmony of the universe among human creatures and among persons, nature, and cosmos. So, very typically, Catholic, Muslims, Buddhists, but with an element which is a common denominator, which definitely unified them. The Focolare presents a spirit based on love and community, and sorry, and communion, and this brings about small or larger communities in different parts of the world. Religion, especially in Europe, is no longer a private affair. It becomes a communitarian reality. But this is also common and typical of the Risho Kosekai movement, where they stress the Sangha, the community of the monks for Buddhism, for traditional Buddhism, but which Nivano widens also to the lay people. He says, a person all alone will never be able to know and to grasp the truth. If we are together, it's much easier to reach the truth. And the Risho Kosekai has, wherever they are in the world, these hosa groups where people can share their problems, and a person with a greater responsibility and a greater experience tries to enlighten the person who is going through the crisis, and the problem is shared by everyone, and also the joy of overcoming the problem. And therefore, it is of religious value to tackle problems, not so much as individuals, but as groups. This is the meaning of Hosa. So communities in the Focolare, then we have the Hosa among Buddhists, and we have also among the Gulen followers, different groups, which Gulen named Jemat. And he says, in our times, no single individual on their own can attain such high spiritual stage, makam for the Muslims. Indeed, we can only seize the heights through the affiliating to a collective personality. So this is sensitiveness to communion, community. As I said before, Gulen calls Jemat community. The Jemat is a unity of individuals sharing the same feelings, thoughts, aims, ideas, adjusting their life along this life of unity, helping the individual to enhance their religious productivity through joint work. It helps to profit from the good deeds which are achieved with others and helps to avoid individual mistakes on the worldly path to God. So these are communitarian dimensions which were born in completely different setups based on completely different holy texts. Another aspect these movements and groups share is that the importance of the scriptures. So they all have a scriptural dimension, and they are all scripture-based organizations. And what is their effort? To make the holy books, which have been usually written thousands of years ago, relevant in today's society. That is the big problem. How to make these books relevant to the men and women who is at the side of us, who seems to be interested in the globalized issue of our society. Now, we know the Focolare, those who know the Focolare, that we try to live every month a center of the gospel, which we call the word of life. And also in the other movements, we try to read, for instance, Gulen texts often refer to the Quran and to an interpretation of the Quran, which a scholar says it's a very orthodox interpretation of the Quran. The Quran is a translation of this universe as a book. Yes, he says, the universe is a book. It is needed for a reader to read this book, which is well organized with all of its verses and pages. The reader is human. An interpretation of this book is the Quran. Allah has sent Quran as a translation of the universe to the human beings who cannot grasp the universe's immense, deep meaning and its huge vision. This meaning that we cannot easily understand by looking at the big pages and phrases of the universe, we can see at first glance in the Quran, the miraculous. Nivano, as I said, draws inspiration from the Lotus Sutra. A Lotus Sutra, which instead goes back to the Nichiren and Tendai Buddhism of the 13th century of the Christian era. And Nivano found in the Lotus Sutra what he sees as the essence of Shakyamuni Buddha's teaching, opening up in an exhaustive way the true form of the universe where we live, the nature of human being, and the modalities of human behavior towards all other living creatures. So the discovery of these men and women have been very common. And Nivano values so much the Lotus Sutra that for 7 years he left his family, wife, and children, and he went in a 7 years long retreat to deepen the Lotus Sutra. And he found in the sacred text all the answers he was looking for. So scriptures has to walk hand in hand with service towards the others. We come to the conclusion. What are the fruits of interreligious dialogue promoted by these movements? And I took three with some reference also to Gandhian movements, very little, but there are many others. I will just quickly mention some of these. First of all, the biggest fruit is a deepening of the relationship of God, with God or with the Absolute. By whom? By the members and the followers of these groups and community. For instance, a young Japanese Buddhist during a meeting with the Focolare said, for the first time, I felt the presence of a Buddha, she said, or the divine within me. A second point, a Theravada Buddhist monk in one occasion mentioned with this sentence something very interesting. Dialogue is based on the most essential part of one's faith. So we don't dialogue with the outskirts of our faith, but we dialogue with the very core of our faith. Otherwise, it is not dialogue. So we cannot leave the most precious things outside a dialogue. Third one is the conviction that interreligious dialogue is based on mutual respect. When these people meet, they feel that they have to respect each other. I remember when a priest, a Catholic priest, very much surprised that Chiara was so much, so close to a Japanese leader like Mikio Nivano, and Chiara mentioned to this priest that, you know, he's a holy man. So the mutual respect to recognize holiness, sanctity in the other person. The fourth point inspires and helps those involved in dialogue to constantly deepen the experience of their own faith. This is an experience that all of us involved in interfaith dialogue live. Each one of us, the more works for dialogue, the more has to go back to the very root of his own, her own faith. If he or she is a Christian, he or she has to go back to the root of Christianity. If he or she is Hindu, the same for Hinduism. The fifth point, these experiences lead also to the certainty that universal brotherhood, sisterhood is possible. Very interesting, the comment of this Muslim, an immigrant, the life of migrants today is not easy at all, in Northern Italy, said, being together, we discover the beauty of each as a mutual gift, not as a threat, but as a mutual gift, so that we give a contribution to see a world united in brotherhood. This is not an utopia, but a dream that can come true, because among us, this is always a reality. So it becomes a reality among us, it can be a reality of brotherhood and sisterhood among everyone. Then the sixth point, such experience makes people capable of highlighting what is common, and yet it does not bring confusion or faiths. Being together, the more we are together, the more we realize how different we are one from the other, and how much these differences are to be kept, at the same time, how much we have in common, and how much we rejoice for these commonalities, which don't spoil our identities. They enrich our identities. And seventh, dialogue together contributes to the healing of social texture. Many experiences can be shared on groups, communities, movements, which have contributed for social issues, and they have contributed to solve local problems. Today, political scientists started giving attention to this phenomenon, and they realized that religions may have a transformative effect on individuals and communities, and no doubt encounter one another within an increasingly global civil society. Mind you that in the West, till a few decades ago, no one was speaking of religion in public. Today, there are state universities which organize seminars. I participated in one of them 2 weeks ago in my own city, a webinar, but in my own city, I know very well that university. In my own time, no one could have mentioned religion in that place. And they had a seminar on the power of religion as a builder of bridges among people. Dialogue, say this political scientist, is not solely or even primarily about theological matters. It involves members of different religious communities speaking out of their own traditions in an effort to better understand and more effectively navigate inevitable cultural, ethical, political differences. Dialogue can have a strategic dimension. Its primary aims are not to prevail over the other, but to reduce conflict, to promote understanding and cooperation across issues of common concern. And with this, I conclude. So I gave a bit of a, how can I say, sketch of the reality across the world, across the religions, just of some movements. As you understand very well, we can speak about each of them for a long time, but it's a very interesting phenomenon, and we have to pay attention to it. Some of us are part of this phenomenon, so we have to be aware of it. We have a responsibility, and we have to work together to make it more and more a beautiful reality. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Roberto. And when you were giving your talk, I was reminded of the conclave which was there in Rome in 2014, where I got the opportunity to interact with organizations like Risho Kosekai, Gulen Movement, the Hizmet Movement. So this has been actually a very dense and profound thought, which was reflected in your talk. And I feel that we need to spread this thought across cultures. And I feel that this talk has given a theoretical basis for the syllabus designed for this course. So this is a very important talk, I would say, because as we are planning to have courses on interfaith dialogue, these courses should be backed with a strong theoretical background. And your talk, Roberto, is actually giving us that insight. The common thread which is seen in the movements which you have mentioned is the acceptance of scriptures as the guiding light, but not blindly following them, but reinterpreting them for the present needs, problems, and doldrums of human life. So let us take questions. So we'll be looking forward to answering questions. So you can type in the chat box and then we can take those questions. So over to the audience. So any questions, anybody wants to react or add their experiences of undergoing the interfaith dialogue, interreligious dialogue? Yeah. So Chandra Prabha has responded. And she says, thank you, Roberto. Such a rich and enlightening presentation, throwing light on the aspects of different faiths. And here we have our Priya Vaidya also, who says, thank you very much for such an enriching presentation. So it is, I feel it is like, vidyate rudaya granthihi chidyante sarva saushayaha. So the doubts which are there in our minds are now clarified with this thought, with the talk which Roberto has given. Jeevan Babu says that good presentation, Honorable Sir, thanking you for great insight. So it was really an insightful thought. And what I felt was the theoretical basis was there. And that that is the key success of this talk. So one question which I would like to ask is that, so when Kiara started the Focolare movement and the interfaith dialogue, was she not met with any kind of conflicts with other religions?
No, I must say no.
Okay.
Chiara comes or came from a region in Italy, northeastern part of Italy, Trent, which is probably the most staunchly Catholic part of Italy, at least at the time when Chiara was born. Mm-hmm. Though in her family, the father was not a practicing Catholic, he was a socialist. The mother was a very pious Catholic lady. The brother was a communist guerrilla partisan against the Nazi. So there was a variety of elements in her family. So somehow she grew in a milieu where they learn how to dialogue with each other. But in Trent, there were no people of other religions. Probably there were a few Jewish people who anyway were very quiet because of the fascist and Nazi domination at the time and the Holocaust which was taking place. Chiara came in contact, there is a very interesting script that we found in these years. In 1963, for the first time, two Indians coming from India to Rome, they asked some of the companions of Chiara to meet because they wanted to know what they were doing. And so the first meeting, let's say, recorded in our archives of Chiara with a person of other religions is with these two Indians. But they, Chiara sent two of her first companions to meet them, but they knew nothing about India, about Hinduism. And they spoke about God who is love and fraternity. And the comment which Chiara reported in her diary is that they said, this is the most important thing that humanity should do. This was the comment. Yeah. So that was the very first time she met with some people of other religions. So in a way, we did it. And she never had major problems, even when the Focolare went to Africa, and in Africa, in the Cameroons, they met with people with a traditional religions, let's say a tribal religions. They, Chiara, understood that sooner or later we could have a relationship with people of other faiths. But in a way, it came along the way without she could expect anything. She was absolutely astonished when things happened.
Wow. Yes. Thank you. So we have Edelweiss responding, and she says, thank you, Roberto, for the deep session. It is good to know that many other movements exist that are also working towards interfaith dialogue. Priya Vaidya has a question, and it is, what is your approach on the process of learning and unlearning to strengthen dialogue? So this is a question by Priya Vaidya.
It's a very interesting, this learning and unlearning to strengthen dialogue. You know, it's very interesting. I answer with something which I love by Pope Francis. Pope Francis speaks of the incomplete thinking, saying and meaning that each of us, everyone, we don't have a way of thinking which can encompass or understand the whole truth. Our thinking is by all means incomplete. So till we are alone, we think that our thinking is complete. When you meet with other people and you start dialogue, you realize how much your thinking is not complete. So in a way, this is the experience that we can live, no? Of learning and unlearning. When we are alone, we may believe that we have understood the truth. When you meet other people, you have understood, you realize that they have understood other aspects of the truth which you have missed. And at that point, you realize that you have to learn a culture of not possessing the truth, but trying to walk towards the truth along with the others.
Yeah. And we have Bernard from Goa saying, thank you, Roberto, for the wonderful sharing from Interfaith Dialogue. One line stood out to me. We love the Creator for the sake of the Creator. Thank you, Bernard, for your wonderful response. Mm. And then Samuel Smith has said, excellent, enlightened, energy rendered, Roberto, sir. Thank you. Then Anil Nepali has also thanked you. And we have Shubhada Joshi madam responding, and she said, dear Roberto, thank you very much for presenting your thought-provoking paper. The concluding remarks are important and are to discuss sometime later in an elaborate way. It's a wonderful speech. Then Anil Nepali again has responded saying that there is a lot of new information given by Roberto. RSV Sukumar says that thank you very much, Roberto, for this stunning and brilliant presentation. We are fortunate to have you because you are really a gifted scholar in the area of interreligious dialogue. Kindly explain major issues related with linguistics in interreligious dialogue.
With linguistics, I thank you for this question because it is a very, how can I say, very crucial, very key question. And I start with a personal experience, which has nothing to do with religion, but it may shed light on how important is the linguistic aspect in dialogue. The people who introduced me said that I worked for a number of years in the as a cultural officer of the Italian consulate in Mumbai. And I remember once the consul asked me to organize a meeting for some Italian journalists and Indian journalists. So we had a round table discussion for about 2 hours, and I accompanied the Italian delegation to this round table. And they discussed about big issues. It was in the mid of the 90s when India was opening up from the economic viewpoint, where there'd been the Ayodhya issue. I mean, there'd been so many problems, and the dialogue went in and on for all this on these points. So what I saw happening in front of my eyes was I give you an image to explain it better. The words pronounced by the Indian journalist were coming out of their mouth with a certain meaning. And they landed in the ears of the Italian journalists and elaborated with a completely different meaning. The word was the same, but the meaning of the Indian and the meaning of the Italian were completely different, and vice versa. When the Italian spoke, it was exactly the same. When we finished, we were on the small bus, which took us back to the hotel. I explained to them what happened. And they looked at me and they could not believe it. They have misunderstood each other for 2 hours, using the same word, but without understanding each other. Now, in religion, we run the risk of doing the same. For instance, even the word God, which is the central word in religion, when I pronounce the word God, is not the same meaning that Madhvi gives to the word God. Why? Because I'm a Christian and she's a Hindu. Cannot be the same meaning in the imagination, in the spirit, in the heart, in the soul. We have a completely different sensitiveness for the reality of God, and it has to be different. So we always have to keep in mind this. Or prayer, it's another word, which is a key word in religion. But prayer for me has a meaning. For a Hindu, has another meaning, the same for a Muslim. So whenever I use words, I must always be careful to to ask the other person what is the meaning for him or for her of that word, especially the words which are more used in interfaith dialogue. Because the meaning is different. They are lived, they are perceived, they are, let's say, they are part of our being, of our mind, of our heart, in a completely different way. And we have to respect this difference. From this we can learn a lot, but we cannot impose a way of using a word over to the other. The example which is really clear is the word dharma. Dharma very often is translated as a religion, but it doesn't give the meaning of religion. It's something much more articulated, much more complex, that you cannot impoverish with the term religion. So we have to be respectful one of the other. And it's very good that we have this sensitiveness.
Yeah. Thank you, Roberto. Cherian sir has a question, and he says, how far these movements, mainly of the non-official dialogue levels, influenced directly or indirectly the official dialogue movements?
More and more, because there are certain bodies which are doing the interfaith dialogue at the official level. For instance, the Vatican, which is the Holy See, the office of the Pope for us Catholics, has a ministry in interfaith dialogue, which we have visited also with some of you in the past. It's called the Pontifical Council for Interfaith Dialogue. And they carry out official interfaith dialogue. We, for instance, from the Focolare, we carry on our own dialogue, and in a way we contribute also to the dialogue that the Holy See, the Pope's office, does. But of course, we do it with our own style, in our own spirit, and for whatever can be useful for them, we can cooperate and collaborate. And for every religion is the same. That's why some political scientists are very interested in these groups and communities, because they realize that sometimes what the official authorities cannot do can be done thanks to these communities. I give you a very practical example. In Italy, all over Europe, especially in the Mediterranean Sea, we have a big problem with migrations now. And one of the most practical, successful solution to the problem of migration is given by one of these movements, the Sant'Egidio community, which opened some humanitarian corridors to help migrants to come safely to Europe. So it's not the government, it's not the church, it's a movement which is paving the way to contribute solving in a positive manner the migration problem.
Okay, thank you, Roberto. One question is asked by Dr. Raja, and he says that I would like to know about challenges you have come across in the dialogue. Challenges in the dialogue.
But challenges are always many. I spoke of the one, for instance, of language. How many times we realized that we thought of having understood each other and we did not understand each other. So in a way, you have to go back and to rebuild a relationship. Or at times you make a mistake without realizing it. I give you an example, very recent example. Just a few days ago, a Muslim friend in Rome from this Gulen movement is met, invited me for dinner. We went out and he asked me to say a prayer. And I said a prayer which is a typically Christian Catholic. And when I realized I was halfway through the prayer, and it was a challenge because I realized that it was a bit out of place in that moment to say that prayer. I could have said a more inclusive prayer. And at the end, I apologized with him. And he said, no, but from you as a Catholic, I expected this. But I felt that I had to apologize. So constantly you have challenges, and you must have the spiritual, the psychological strength to start again whenever you make mistakes as a person and also as a group. And you know, dialogue requires a lot of patience, but really lot of patience.
Right. Thank you. And Dr. Andiyappan has responded saying, thank you, Roberto, for the informative and effective deliberation. You are right that that commonalities of different religions are there, have their anthropological approach. Dipali Bhanoth has also thanked you, saying that thank you for explaining the judicious use of the correct vocabulary in interreligious dialogue. So I thank the participants also for raising very poignant and important questions in this talk. So on behalf of the on my personal behalf, I as well as on behalf of the Ecumenical Christian Center, Sri Ramakrishna Math, and the Focolare movement, I extend warm regards and thanks to Roberto for giving such a enriching and enlightening session on dialogue as a prophecy. So with this, I hand over the charge to Caroline for doing the further procedures. Over to Caroline.
Thank you, Madhavi. Thank you for guiding us so well in this session. Thank you, Roberto. And you have received many thanks from all the participants. I believe Father Matthew.
Roberto, Madhavi, Caroline, and all the friends. I must say that this is a very splendid and very meaningful, insightful discussion, presentation by Roberto. And we could see that the great achievement of the Focolare movement initiated by Chiara Lubich is that it is very spontaneous. Nobody told her to make such a movement, and she was never part of any Catholic movement. So it was from her own within that inspiration that fired into a great movement. And her achievement, I understand that it is not that holding her movement as just one, but she was weaving a network with all other religious dimensions. I am very happy that you have presented that the Saint Egido from the Catholic community and also from the Muslim community, Gulen, then also from the Japanese, the Japanese Buddhist and the Thailand Theravada Buddhist, and then all the various other movements and the African, Indian, Gandhian movements, you know, all were under a kind of an umbrella. So I think this is what we need today. It is not the official dialogue and other so but much more than that, the individual inspirations and networking. So they have the greatest impact on the society. So that is the reason why in 77 Chiara Lubich was given the Templeton Prize. So Roberto has well presented, and the need of the day, as he has well presented there, is that, you know, this networking, weaving together of various other movements together. And I must say that, you know, the officials of the dialogue movements, whether it be Catholics or whether it be other ecumenical bodies or interfaith dialogue of other religious traditions, they must be inspired by these movements. They should take it up much more than what because they are expected to do the work. So the others are doing out of their own resources. So I think that all the more the official bodies should take into account in making such movements much more vigorous. That was what Pope Francis was saying, and that is what he was also doing. He was going to the Muslim countries, to the Hindu countries, the Buddhist countries, and then as Narsi, I think one saint from the Sufism was saying, we love the created for the sake of the creator. Unfortunately, what we see today is that, you know, in the name of religion, there are so much of divisions. And that can only be coming from the profiling of one particular religion, that you should all follow us. But what we have been presented today is that, you know, there are beauty, there are ethics, wonderful things. And if we come together, that will make us into a beautiful community, peace, progress. All this will be there. So thank you, Roberto. And Madhavi has well coordinated and as moderated. And Caroline, she was also the inspiration. And thank you very much in the name of Ecumenical Christian Center and for everyone. So we have lots of people very patiently listening and contributing. And the next Thursday, it is another great reformer of the 8th century, Sri Shankaracharya. There is a professor and also a Catholic priest who has done his Acharya in Sanskrit. So he was an ardent follower and of Shankaracharya. So he has already written a well long documentation, and which could be shared in advance so that you can read through what is Sri Shankaracharya. So that will be sent to all of you, and then most welcome for the next Thursday so that we can have another fruitful discussion. So I thank Roberto, Madhavi, Caroline, and all of you for this wonderful coming together in dialogue. Thank you,
Father Matthew.
Thank you.
Thanks to all of you.
Thank you for organizing this. We will, as usual, you, for those doing the certificate course, we will be sending you a question for reflection. Even those who don't want to send a write-up, maybe I will share the question that with Father Matthew we thought could lead to some more reflection on what Roberto gave us today. So how are new religious movements collaborating in their mission of building bridges? And what fruits can be perceived in interfaith dialogue so far? So we leave you with that thought. And we'll see you again on Thursday. Stay safe, keep well. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.